I don't know what people are expecting in wilderness survival. I don't know what the YouTube people are teaching everybody. It's about time we talk about wilderness survival from a real world perspective. Don't see too much of that. So let's get to it. When it gets too dark, I will throw on the headlamp. So check out this beautiful sunset, guys. This is what I get to do. Okay, so we just got out of our winter season. We had our final blizzard winter storm, and I was out doing my neighborly thing, checking on the neighbors, checking on people, finding stuck freaking cars, getting them rescued. Of course, I was out on the ATV, but I was also prepared to march around on foot if need be. You know, ATVs do get stuck even in the snow. Things can happen. If you're on foot, maybe you get into trouble. So with that being said, let's talk about what I carried on me, because people have asked, Randall, you're not running around with your AR-15 machine gun and all this stuff when you're out doing your thing? Like, no, usually not. I try to carry the rifle whenever I can, but if I'm out doing the neighborly thing, there's not really a point to having combat gear on me and a freaking machine gun on me. You know, it can also freak people out. I mean, imagine you're stuck out in the mountains in a snowstorm, and the only person that comes by who could possibly help you looks like freaking Rambo with what most of these people think is a machine gun strapped to his chest. Okay, so there is always a method to the madness. All right, guys, it is expert lighting time. Yes, professional. I'm going to throw out a couple things that's probably going to hurt some feelings, especially in the YouTube survival bushcraft community. I'll just tell you guys, you know, what you see on the internet isn't always reality. It's usually not. But I'm going to talk about what I actually carry when I'm out doing my thing in blizzard or roving around, and it's my minimalist survival kit. So the first thing that's probably going to rub people the wrong way is, if I get into trouble out here, all right, my main course of action is to just walk the hell home. Let's say the ATV gets stuck or broken down or won't start or whatever. Guys, I can walk, okay? That's something I don't see the survival people talking about. If you can walk, you can walk yourself out of trouble. And what I like to say is, if I walked myself into trouble, I can walk my happy ass back. I've done it several times. I've been out here plenty of times exploring these hills, and something has gone wrong with the ATV, flat tire usually, and I don't have a repair kit, I don't have a spare, so I just get to walk my happy ass back, climb up and down the hills, and get my butt home, go grab a truck and a trailer, and go do some self-recovery. And I think that should be everyone's course of action one. You don't have to go to survival mode as soon as something starts to go wrong. If you are healthy and fit and you are not injured, you can walk, okay? I don't understand why we get into this dreamland of going primitive camping, building freaking mud hut hobo shelters in the woods and all this craziness. You know, think about the time it takes to build one of these survival shelters, like guys using freaking cordage, lashings, logs, cutting up stuff and everything. And they're healthy. It's like, dude, you're fit and you're not injured. You walk your ass home. Why are you building shit in the woods? All right, so that's course of action one. I walk my ass home, all right? And it's happened plenty of times. Course of action two would be what we do not want, where I'm actually injured. Okay, so guess what I'm going to do, guys? I'm going to start the biggest damn fire I can think of, all right? That fire is going to be so big, doesn't matter if it's winter or summer and like wildfire season, I'm building a huge freaking fire, all right? So big that it can be seen. And guess what? If you're in areas like this, as soon as there's smoke in the air, especially if it's in the dry season, planes will start flying. They'll start looking at stuff. Okay, so that's when we get to our signaling, trying to get rescued and everything. That's my main course of action. Now, if we're talking about winter time, I do have one of the emergency survival blankets on me. I do have the skills to build little small shelters with me. I mean, it's not really that hard to hunker down a cluster of pine trees like what we see behind us, and that'll keep you warm and dry. All right, you could build your little shelter around you. You can do your sticks and all that stuff, and get bundled up and you'll be okay. And again, my priority, if I cannot walk my ass out of here, is going to be to build the biggest damn fire I can freaking possibly imagine. Once I get a good fire going, I'm just going to throw everything onto it and try to signal the whole freaking, the entire valley that there's a freaking fire up here, all right? So let's talk about just a few things that I have with me. So if we get to course of action one, where I'm gonna walk my happy ass out, it doesn't matter. If it's 20, 30, 50 miles, I'm freaking planning to walk home, all right? I know people think that's crazy, especially in blue jeans. Here we go with the freaking blue jeans again. You know, the internet trolls will tell you if it's less than 50 degrees outside and you walk outside in blue jeans, you're gonna die because cotton kills. You will literally die. Okay, so let's talk about some of the realistic stuff we're carrying if we don't wanna run around like we're freaking Rambo and we're just terrified of the woods. It's just, hey, I got into a little bit of trouble. I have to walk a pretty long way to get home, but I'm gonna be okay. So what do I need to have on me? Okay, first, I do have the sidearm. It's always right here. Now I know concealed carry, if I'm in a regular people world, it's gonna be right here on the front concealed, but I got all this stuff on. I'm sitting on the ATV for the most part. And even if I get off the ATV and I walk around the woods, I'm gonna have it right here on my hip, freaking Western style. I am totally comfortable with that, okay? If you don't like that, carry your pistol where you want. I like it here. If I'm out on foot and I happen to run into somebody else, I don't know why they're gonna be out in horrible conditions like me, but if I run into people, all I gotta do is cover it up and it doesn't look like I have anything on me. And that's part of the social skills you kind of develop. You don't wanna run around like freaking Rambo. I'm prepared to kill everybody around me, but I don't have to look like it. Right now, I just look like a dude in the mountains with a radio on me. I do have my cell phone on me because I'm not trying to hide from anybody. If I do go missing, I want to be found. And if my cell phone has been pinging towers, it's gonna show up. So we do have the phone. If I do get into trouble, I can just make a freaking phone call if I have service. All these mountains behind me, I can climb up on top of them and at least a couple of them, I know I can get service. Maybe I'm injured, but I can move a little bit. I can just get my ass on top of one of these hilltops, get service, and make that call or send out a text to the people that I know will help me or get help for me. Next, we've got the radio. Now, this is the Sad Ham's favorite radio because it is the best in the world. Best made, it's durable. It's surviving this rain somehow. I don't know how, but it's doing okay and it still works. I have all the repeaters for this entire friggin' area within 20 miles programmed on this thing. So for my pace plan, primary is the cell phone. Alternate is this. I can turn this on and talk to any repeater in the area. And yes, I can be all the way down in that valley and I know I can hit at least two repeaters. No problem. So that's my alternate. So let's keep going through the rig. So I've got a digital compass on my watch. I've got a digital compass on my phone, and then I've got this backup analog compass. Now this is a cheapo compass, nothing special, just a cheapo hang-off compass. Yes, the metal around me does mess with it. It does have to be perfectly level, but if my watch is not working, my primary, and my phone compass is not working, well guess what, I can pull this out, get it away from my vest, and boom, it works. And it's accurate. North is that way. Awesome. Cheap old freaking compass hanging out right there, ready to go. So now I have three ways of knowing which direction I need to go. Another thing survivalists don't talk about. What's the point in the compass if you don't know which direction you're supposed to go in the first place? I know the area I'm in. If I'm out patrolling or trying to help other people and I get into trouble, I freaking know where I am. I have shit programmed on my watch. If my watch battery dies because I'm a dummy and didn't put it in stealth mode and all that to save the battery, well then I got my freaking phone. If I don't have service and my phone's not working, I still know which direction I need to go. Because it's cold, I do have my wool gloves, and on the ATV I have some thicker, more heavy-duty mittens. Uh-oh, that's gonna suck if we get lightning. I don't wanna be on a hilltop and lightning. Well, on my body, I have, everybody's bringing Rambo knives or other stuff. I got a multi-tool, right? I can do everything with the multi-tool. I can cut stuff. I got pliers. I'm okay with that. People need saws and axes and all this stuff. Dude, I haven't had to cut anything with a freaking axe in forever. If I do think I might need to chop some stuff up or dig or whatever, I have a e-tool, and it's a newer e-tool. It has a pickaxe included on it. I could take that with me, and now I've got that. I could also use that to beat the crap out of somebody if I don't want to have to shoot them. So I have two protein bars, 400 calories a piece. I will be okay to get home with that. We've got the headlamp, which is what's pointed at me right now. That's important. We've got a spare magazine. I don't know why I'm getting into firefights in a survival situation, but 30 rounds for my mini pew-pew, it's good to have. I might have to shoot an animal, I don't know, for food or whatever, if it tries to attack me and take my stuff. Might have to shoot a couple meth heads. So it's good to have extra ammo. Doesn't weigh that much anyway. Okay, then we got a tack light. Why have a headlamp and a tack light? Well, check it out, guys. Yeah, you will not be missed. It is unbelievable. So the tack light is so I can see more than my headlamp if I need to, but it's also to help me signal for rescue. In terms of signaling for rescue, we've got our old school signaling panel. This came off of the German Feldduken stuff. Outstanding, man. I keep these with me. They're in all of my gear tucked away. Bright freaking orange signaling panel with cordage on it. Very handy. So during the day, this is not hard to be seen. Another signaling device. Where is it? You guys have my light. So this is badass. If we're talking about aircraft that we're trying to hit, maybe the tack light doesn't work, or maybe I don't trust it, or maybe they're not understanding what I'm doing. I've got a high-powered laser. This, I've looked at this through night vision and IR and thermals. It'll show up in FLIR and everything. And I can get a mile out of this freaking thing. So you probably can't see it on camera, but I can hit the next ridgeline out there right now. I can see it. If it's foggy at all, this thing lights up the whole freaking area. And I'm telling you guys, if you hit a pilot with one of these, especially if he's already thinking about search and rescue, you are being seen. You're going to piss him off, but at least you're going to draw his attention. And he might wonder, why is somebody down there in this blizzard or this wildfire area pointing a freaking laser at me? Then once they start to get closer to see what the hell they want to do to me, this asshole that's shining a light at him, well, I got my freaking signaling thing, or I got my tack light. I can signal them even more. Now, continuing with the signaling, this is also something that's good for if I do have to set up a campsite. This is the newer version of the old school rescue devices from the military. All right, so you've got a IR lens on there. You can't see that right now. You pull that off and boom, you've got this going, all right? Your little flash thing. I actually used something like this, the real military one in Ramadi. We would set them up in our OPs so pilots wouldn't shoot at us when we were sitting on rooftops. And we would leave it on the IR cat, just string it up, you know, so pilots would see that. But if I do have to set up a survival camp, all right, and I'm still hoping to be rescued, but I need to get some sleep, I can just set this up and just leave this pointed up. Okay, so any plane flying over will spot this. Now, in a real-world survival situation, I don't need the IR lens. That's more of a tactical thing. But it's cool to have this just going off for me. I can't tell you how long these civilian ones last, but this is a lot newer than the military one that I had. And it's a lot smaller and not as bright. So I'll tell you, the ones I used in Ramadi that were a lot bigger and used a lot more power, we could still get days out of them. Days, okay? So think about that in a survival situation. You got fresh batteries in there. I'm going to check it before I step out the door to go try to help other people. Well, now I can just set that up, and I know I've checked the batteries, and I do have extra batteries on me. So I just string that up, set up my shelter, do a fire. Now pilots have this big old fire that I've set, hopefully a wildfire, and they might be looking down like, huh, who the hell's got a strobe running down there camping? Oh, there's this scenario going on down there. Maybe this person needs help. And in addition, as soon as I see that pilot, I'm going to hear him fly over because I'm in a survival situation. I'm freaking flashing my tack light and my laser and everything at him, trying to get his attention. So if the dude hasn't figured out something is going wrong down there, Well, pilots generally tend to be smarter than that, right? So the dude's probably coming down for me. So people say, well, what about water and survival? Okay, I'm glad you asked. So somewhere in here, water purification tablets, right? The whole freaking jar that you get with a whole bunch of them. Each tablet will treat 1 quart or 1 liter of water. That's an entire canteen. And somewhere, if I can find it behind the light, we've got beer. That's our water container. I could catch water right now. All right, it's all muddy and screwed up. 1 quart canteen. I have one of these with me always and forever. Everywhere I go, no matter what I'm doing. So people say, where is your fancy water container? How are you going to carry that? Guys, I got a back pocket in my jeans. It's unbelievable. Boom. If I have to leave my ATV, I don't need a sophisticated belt system. I don't need a chest rig to carry my water. I got a freaking back pocket. I have hiked that way in 100 degree temps so many freaking times. There's plenty of times where I'm doing tours out here and escorting people around, checking out dams and stuff like that. And we get out, they got their big old hiking backpacks and chest rigs and all this cool guy stuff. I get out, I grab my freaking canteen, it goes in my back pocket, and then I got a full quart on me. And then, like when I'm doing some of these tours, we get to the waterfalls that I'm walking them out to show them. And they're like, oh, what are you gonna do for water? Huh, put my canteen under the giant waterfall we walked out there to check out. Throw a purification tab in there just to make sure. I'm not really worried about waterfall water, but throw a purification tablet in there just to double check, and we're good to go. I have a med kit on my ATV that is this big. I will take that off. It has a cravat in it, it has a chest seal, and it has a combat gauze in it, okay? I can do everything I need to do with that. I'm not treating gunshot wounds. I'm not freaking back storming Ramadi, Iraq. I'm in a wilderness survival situation. I will gladly take that little square pouch off of my ATV, mount it to my belt clip, and there we go. I don't know what people are expecting in wilderness survival. I don't know what the YouTube people are teaching everybody, but look, let's go back to course of action one. If you walked yourself into that situation, or even drove yourself into that situation, you can walk your ass out. That's just another example of being freaking fit. It's not that hard. Stay in some kind of decent shape, so when you get into trouble, you can walk your happy ass out. The average person who doesn't even train a whole bunch, I know they could survive a 20-mile walk even through the mountains, and they would live, okay? Even if they're not even in that good a shape. An actual fit dude, yeah, I'm expecting you to cover 20, 25 miles a day without dying, and you will be okay. Between all the things we got, I'm going to be fine. Then you have the final course of action. Well, Randall, what if you're hurt and you just get into trouble and you can't do all this hardcore grunt stuff? Okay, let's revert back to course of action three. I'm injured. I'm going to actually set up some kind of little shelter. I've got my emergency freaking survival blanket. I'm going to make sure I'm warm and dry, hopefully under some pines where I will stay dry and warm. And then I'm going to set the biggest freaking fire I possibly can. The fire will keep me warm. I don't need a whole bunch of extra food. I don't have to go down there and start fishing and shooting game and everything. Because, guys, even in the most remote parts of America, help will eventually come, okay? If you don't believe that, go out to where you think is super remote. Just find any place in America where you think it's super remote. And go set a massive freaking fire. I guarantee you, within minutes, a plane will be overhead. And they'll come down there and arrest your ass for setting a giant fire. But it will be proof that you are not totally isolated, like everybody thinks. And it will also prove to you that setting a giant fire is a pretty damn good signal. Hey guys, well, that is it. I hope you enjoyed this. Hope you learned something. I'm not purposely kicking other YouTubers in the gonads or, you know, crapping on anybody else. Everybody's got their style. Everybody wants to talk about stuff. But I just wanted to put my spin on a minimalist, basic, real-world survival kit. I'm not planning on building shelters and camping out and living off the land and all this stuff. I'm going to walk my ass out of there. If I'm injured, I'm going to set a big old fire, and I'm going to signal everybody with every freaking thing that I have, make calls and everything, and make sure somebody finds me. And then I'm also prepared to shoot the bad guys that come by that want to take advantage of me. So, thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one. Out. And I almost forgot, but I realized because I know the experts will comment on this. Well, how are you going to start a fire? Where's your ferro rod? Guys, big lighter. Carry these in the woods. I have an extra one in my bag. Ferro rods are cool and all, but it sucks trying to start a fire, especially when you're cold and wet. One big lighter is good. Two, which I have an extra one on my quad, is better. I'm sure I have one in my bag on the ATV that I could pull out if I have to walk out of here. Freaking big lighters, guys.